I'm a little biased towards the Advent reader, but that's okay. I want you to know this Advent season, whether you have known it or not, has been primarily of those who have joined the church or we have been introduced to the church over this last year. And that's been a great, great honor and a great opportunity for us to be able to do. I do want you to know that tonight, as we finish this up, I'm going to try to keep this as short as I can because let's just be honest. Love this time together, but we all want to go drink hot chocolate in the back and have the birthday cake and everything else. So it's a lot more fun back there. But I also want us to go ahead and let's talk really quickly. I want to share with us and just spend some time together, really in the process of what is an opportunity for us to spend time together one more time before we close out this year. If you have your Bibles, I do want to encourage you to open them up to Luke chapter 2. This whole Advent season, I have been a little bit of everywhere. We talked about hope, we talked about peace, love, and joy. And we've done it in a little bit of a different mode than what you're probably used to. Advent is usually this time where we're able to slow down, and we are even able to take the time, don't get me wrong. Baptists are very much, hey, we need to be, we're serious, we're serious Christians. Don't doubt that. But there's also times for us to have fun, and there's times for us to laugh, and there's times for us to have fun together. So that's the reason why this whole series has sort of been the Griswold edition, and I've enjoyed it. Some things that you may not have noticed, and I'm going to point them out to you because they're going to go away after tonight. How many of you think that you know where this girl has been throughout this whole series? I think there's like two of you, right? Okay, I'll show you one of you. We've had a traveling squirrel that has made it. You all didn't even know it was Sunday. It was actually in a tree right there. It was great. I love it because it's a photo. No one can see it. There's a lot of jokes up here that are sort of family jokes. I'm obviously not a Chicago Bears fan, I'm a Packers fan, so there's a Packers hat instead of a Chicago Bears hat. One that you all probably can't see at all, and it makes me laugh because only I can really see it, is there's actually a sign right here next to my carpet, and it actually says, why is the carpet all wet on? That's right here, you can't see it, but it's funny, and I'm black. Something doesn't probably think I'm the only one in class. That's okay. Why? Well, because this is transparency. If we had to put our family somewhere between the family of Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, and the Griswolds, where would you rank? I don't know about you, but I'm probably close. My family's probably closer to the Griswolds than we are anywhere else. I mean, to the point, I mean, the number of stories I can tell you about family members and it's just hilarious. One of them involves my Uncle Stan, and he really did think that one of the other family members' real name was Eddie, because we kept calling him Cousin Eddie after the movie. That's not his real name. He called him Eddie for at least 3 or 4 years before anyone ever told him. You know, that's not his real name, right? But it's all part of the experience. One of my favorite scenes in the movie is at the very beginning. And they start walking, they're trying to find the perfect Christmas tree, and you see the lights, and as they're walking, the daughter continually talks about how cold she is, right? And one of my favorite line that happens there is because the mom, Ellen, says, Audrey's now frozen from the waist down. And Dad, Clark, he says, that's all part of the experience, honey. What is really part of the Christmas experience? Let's just be, talk to me. If I was to ask you about your traditions, what would you say? Some of you have a tradition where you may go and cut your own Christmas tree down. Some of you may have a tradition of, hey, we always go and do this, or we always go and do that. Okay. We all have different traditions. That's fine. But let's really talk about what it means to have a tradition of being Christian. Was one of the things that Christmas allows us to do is to celebrate Christ. How do you celebrate Christ? And so it's a nice sort of opportunity for us to do that. We're going to walk through pretty quickly. Luke chapter 2 is where we're going to go. And I want to point out a few different things from this before, because again, we've sort of been doing a very practical move of this. Of this Advent, and so I want to do that with you tonight. Luke chapter 2, and I'm going to read the whole story because during the Happy Birthday Jesus party with kids in the back, that's going to be our time to actually just read the story together, okay? And read it on their level, and I love doing that part of it. Well, Luke chapter 2, I want you to know these are the verses that you've probably heard every year, you probably have read multiple times. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed, all the world should be registered. I love either way you want to write that. And this first registration was when Aquinas was the governor of Syria. And all went out to be registered, all went out to be taxed, each in his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed. His wife, who was with great with child. I always love the King James there because it says, who was great with child. This is important for us. Why? We'll point out a few things to you. Now, what was part of Jesus' experience trying to get here on earth? I don't know. We always give Joseph a little bit of a hard time with Mary and all those types of things. But can you just hear something, Joseph? Being a, not necessarily a loving husband, but being a husband to Joseph, it's all part of the experience, Mary. Ooh. Let's talk about that really quickly, right? So she was great with child. This means that she was what? She was at the end of that pregnancy. Ever met a pregnant lady who was at the end of her pregnancy? They've lost all the happiness part, right? Like, they're done being happy. What are they? They might be a touch miserable. They might be a touch cranky. I want you to understand something really quickly. Depending on, there was two ways for Joseph and Mary to travel, and either of the two ways, it was pretty close to 92 miles that they'd have to travel. Even if they could travel at 3 miles an hour, that's about walking speed, mile every 20 minutes, I want you to know that it would it'd be somewhere between 70 and 20 miles a day for 5 days. Now, put that back into the context of Mary was great with child. I want you to try to walk 20 miles with a very pregnant lady every day for 5 days and see what she says to you. I don't know. It's not written in our Bible, but I'm pretty sure Mary at some point told Joseph, I hate you. Why? She was great with child. So let's talk about it. Part of the experience. So was Jesus' entrance into this world, was it easy or was it convenient? No, it wasn't. And yet, whenever we talk about things, especially when we talk about Christianity, we go, well, shouldn't that be convenient? Shouldn't it be easy? Well, let's go back to Jesus, because whatever we are, Christianity needs to be a reflection of Christ. Was it convenient or is it easy? And the answer really should be no, it shouldn't. Jesus' entrance into this world started off with his mother and father doing a 92-mile trek just to try to get to the house, get to Bethlehem, so that they could be taxed, so that they could be counted, so that they could make sure that they knew the numbers that were still in Israel during that time. This is exactly what this is the beginning of that relationship. And what's interesting about this is that Luke is kind of the only one who really talks about this. Mark doesn't talk about it at all. Neither does John. John in John's version of the gospel, Jesus is eternal. Mark is he references that Jesus is from Galilee, but that's kind of it. And Matthew's the only other gospel that talks about it, but Matthew doesn't talk about this. He goes and he talks about it completely differently. I love that. So we have all we're stuck with this sort of loop with this idea. So what was part of the experience? Part of the first part of that experience was that it was hard to do. I don't know about you, but some of you are facing this Christmas season and it is hard to do. I want you to know that you are in very good company. Should we stop there? No, I want you to go just a little bit further into it. Was Jesus born into a life that was, I want to use the word soft, right? Not necessarily a lot of new terms that have come along today. It's a cupcake type of a life. No, it was an easy type of life. No, I really want the idea of soft, right? Luxurious. Jump down to verse number 6 with me. Okay? Because Jesus is born. And while they were there, it was time for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger. Because there was no place, there was no room for them in the inn. So let's start off again. Jesus was born into this world. Here he is, King of the Jews, the Messiah. Was his life luxurious from the beginning? Again, the answer is no. There's no room for them in the end. So I want you to know, I want to give you for the absolute best of probably what actually is the example. So, there's no room for them in the end. If you take a moment and you study this, it could mean that they were in the guest room of a house. I don't think that's exactly where it's at because it says they laid him in the manger. Alright, so we go down from there. In Israel during this time, I want you to know, very common practice to have a two-layer house. On the top floor is where everybody's safe. On the bottom floor is where all the animals stay. You kind of coexisted together. It's really easier. It's easier that way. So let's just say it was that. It wasn't. Well, let's just say it was. Then what? Well, then Mary could have had help because there's other people somewhere close around, right? All you have to do is sort of yell, and someone probably from upstairs would come down and help. More than likely, it wasn't that either. So we keep moving down. Well, maybe it was a room attached to the back of the house. Again, popular in Israel during this time was to have a multiple-layer house, and the animals sort of stayed out back, attached to a shed-ish looking thing that was built so that they wouldn't, leave. We can kind of go there. I'm okay with that. Why? Well, again, is this point in time, Bethlehem is so busy, this is the only place they have left to stay. More than likely, is a cave. And I kind of like that idea almost a little bit better. Innkeeper would have had enough room that he owned enough stuff that he would have had a separate place for families to live entirely. That's all. And whenever they says there's no room for them in the inn, that's exactly the thought you have to go with. Is Jesus, is the innkeeper sitting there going, "Look, I got people everywhere. I have nothing else for you. The only thing I can offer you is where my animals stay, and all that's really going to do is keep the rain off of me.
Maybe. If Ruth doesn't drink. And it's like, oh. So, was it like soft? Here's an opportunity. They weren't able to stay in the guest room. They weren't able to stay in the house. And they weren't even on the back of the house. They had to stay far, far away. I want you to think about it from the standpoint. And you hear the sermon often. There's no room for the end. There's no room for Jesus there. The question is always asked to us, do you have room for Jesus? Which is a great sermon. Don't get me wrong. But if we're going to talk about a life of luxury, this is definitely not it, right? He was in a manger. They wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger. Now, if you ever do a great look of this, I want you to know what I don't have one up here this year. We usually have this nice little wood structure, right? It kind of looks almost like a bat, like something you put hay in. It was more closer related to a big stone, okay, that had been hewed out or dug out just deep enough for the farmer to come through and throw food into it. So his first bed was what? Wasn't nice and soft, was it? Stone. Hard. I think it's Max Lucado who says that, I want you to think about it from this point perspective, where regardless of where he was, Jesus' first smells of a baby on earth were what? Animals. Manure. Here is the Messiah. Here is our Lord. And what does he come into a world of? Hardship. Comes into a place where it's difficult. Difficult start. Difficult to get off. And your hope, we're not even told this. You're hoping you're praying, it doesn't rain. Right? It wasn't soft. Wasn't luxurious, wasn't anything like that. It was actually very, very different. Whenever we're talking about things, this is a beautiful time of year, beautiful time to think about. But I want you to know, if you're facing something hard, facing something difficult, I want you to know you're going to break out. Because Jesus, his interest in the world is exactly the same. Now, what's his life? I was like the last one. What's life? Was his life a purpose? And the answer is absolutely yes. The verses that we read that I'm very glad that Cam got to read because, again, I'm still kind of bitter growing up because I felt like this section of verses were always given to some girl at church to read. None of the guys ever got to read them. So Cam got to read them tonight just out of pure bitterness that I'm still holding on to 35 years later. Not I'm holding on to it much. I want you to read along with me. Verse number 10. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. So, I want you to know, what do the angels do? Angels proclaim God at the very beginning. A Savior is born, a Savior to the world, Jesus. Now, what's great about this, and I'm going to try to wrap up because I know I got some answers. That's okay. They don't bother me. Let's talk about it really quick. Joy. Let's go through Advent. Because Advent is the coming of Christ. And I want you to know, I want to steal from Bonhoeffer. If you never read some of the classic people, go back and read Bonhoeffer. Because it's one of the things that he says, which I love dearly, is that because we are Christians and we live in a post Christ has already ascended. We're waiting for the second advent. We're waiting for the second coming of Christ. Every day is advent for us. And I'm excited for that. Why? Because what was the first? It says you shall bring joy to all people. I love that. Because if you ever talk to a Christian and you start really associating with them, and all of a sudden you're going, wow, there really is joy there. The exact opposite is when I talk to a non-Christian, what do I ever see? It's joy. Hope. I love this because if you ever talk to a Christian, talk to someone who, if you could talk to them before they were saved and after they were saved, what's the biggest difference in their life? Hope. Do you have hope? I do. Why? Why do you have hope? Well, because my Bible actually tells me. Tells me about things that are going to happen. It tells me that things are going to get worse in this world before Christ comes, before another advent happens. Okay? So why am I not surprised when it happens? World's going to get worse. Why? I want to keep praying for what? Come quickly, Lord Jesus. Why? Because I hope. Hope that what? Christ is going to come. So that I joy to have the hope, then what's left for me to do? Continue walk around the advent candle. What's next? Love. We love. It's a symbol. Christians are supposed to be a reflection of Christ. We love. What's the famous verse from 1 John 4? I love because He first loved me. You want a great sermon for Christmas Eve? Stop right there at 1 John. Why? Because that's the whole point of us doing this together. Christ loved us. We have an opportunity to love other people. Last but not least is peace. Do you live your life in a place of peace? You're able to communicate? Are you able to be in such a place where you know you can lay your head down at night because you have peace? It doesn't matter what happens to you. One of the favorite things I love quoting, especially when I talk about peace, is actually from the guy, from Spurgeon himself. And the story is that he was going to see his sister in Chicago, and a storm came up. And they asked him, said, you know, Pastor, why is it that you can rest so easily? And he simply said, I have a sister in Chicago and a sister in heaven, and I do not care which one I see first. Why? Why was he able to say that? Because he had peace. Why? To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. When we talk about all of these together, this is what we're waiting for. Now I understand you're living in a world and you have family that's coming in, and you have family that you're just going, God, so many things that we love to quote from this movie, right? Could be more surprised if I woke up tomorrow, right? I couldn't. You know, is there anything else I can get you? Maybe take you out into the middle of the woods. Why? Because we're family. We're dealing with each other. Christian family is no different. We're still dealing with one another. Here's the difference for us. We have Christ. We are part of the same family, and that allows us to celebrate this time together. So, I want to take just a little bit of time. I want us to sort of close with just a little bit of a challenge. And then we'll hear our game live. So, let's do this. I want you to listen. I want you to understand that maybe God has not called you to a life of ease. That's okay. Maybe God has not called you to a soft life. And guess what? Again, that's okay. But God has called you to a life of hope, peace, joy, and love. And why is that? It's because of God. So, this is what I want us to do right now. Where I'm going to ask us to pray again. As we draw this point, draw this to a close, I'm going to give you a couple of instructions. Here in just a moment, we're going to turn almost all the lights off. I'm sorry for the watching on Facebook. You may not get the whole experience. Sorry. Should be here. But I want you to know, this is the most beautiful thing about candlelight services. This is the example of what Christ has called us to do. Christ has told us what? He is the light. Not only do you have the light, but if you share the light, guess what happens? The room keeps getting brighter. So here's just a moment. Again, bear with us as we have to go through this. And then after we get done with the singing and the candlelight and everything else, I'm still going to ask you to stay where you are. But it's an opportunity for us. We're going to have an opportunity here in just a moment to really introduce somebody to the church family. I'm excited about that. It's all part of the church. This is part of our Christmas too. So let's pray together. Lord, we come to you at this point in time and we say thank you for this day. God, as we read the story and as we talk about how you came into this world, may we understand, Lord, that you did not have it easy. It was not convenient, and it was not soft. And Lord, when we look at our lives, when we come across some of those same conclusions, may we understand that it's the exact same for you. But God, you have called us to a life of peace. You've called us to a life of hope, of joy and love, and you've called us that because of you. Lord, may we live it. May we go throughout the Christmas season, may we go throughout our year, may we go throughout our life reflecting that. And may we always be ready looking for the next step when you come again. Lord, we thank you for all of this. Lord, it's in your Son's name we do pray. Amen. Master, please stand as they start turning off the lights and we have your candles ready. We will start sharing some of that.
Tony, if you would please turn on just a couple of lights for us. You can go ahead and blow out your candles if you would for the make sure we don't set anything else on fire. Although it did pour back to 11 minutes, so that was nice. I want to ask you if you would please stay standing just for a moment and go ahead and end our time on Facebook and recording.